So I wanted to, for those of you who are not familiar with the UDN, wanted to give you a very quick introduction. So the Undiagnosed Diseases Network, or UDN in short, is a clinical and basic science research program that is funded through the NIH Common Fund. It began in 2014 and is going to run through 2022. The network is composed of 12 clinical sites, and you can see the states that these sites are located in. They're supported by a number of cores that help us perform the research, and there's a coordinating center. The mission of the network is to take individuals who've had failed diagnostic attempts, multiple sometimes, and they have an underlying disease that hasn't been diagnosed. So the network accepts these patients, we clinically evaluate them, we perform some genome sequencing when indicated, and as necessary, utilize the research network that we have in order to make diagnoses. Every patient who is accepted into the UDN used to travel to the clinical site for about a week prior to COVID, where all their clinical evals could happen. As you can imagine, that has changed significantly for us. And so that will build into the telehealth findings in the UDN that I'm going to present. So a very quick introduction as to what are the numbers that the UDN has achieved so far in terms of making diagnoses. So this, you can ignore the left part of this figure. I know it's busy and hard to see, but that illustrates just the history of the network. What I'd like you to focus on is we've gotten about 4,300 applications from across the United States. You can see the map there, and as well as different parts of the world. Everybody is eligible to apply to the UDN irrespective of their geography or their financial circumstances. We've accepted close to 1,500 patients, and about 434 diagnoses have been made. So about 30% of individuals across the clinical sites obtain a diagnosis through the network. That's pretty remarkable considering these individuals have already had multiple failed attempts, including a sequencing that hasn't provided a diagnosis. So what has COVID done to us? We don't have a lot of data on the patient evaluations yet, but we do have some data on the applications in the UDN due to COVID. So this bar shows you the annual applications starting from 2016. And as you can tell, we were having a steady increase, and then COVID hit and our application rate has dropped significantly. In addition, if you look at the breakdown per month, at 2019 is the bar in blue and 2020 are the bars in green. You can see across every month starting in May, March, April through May, application volume drop compared to the prior months before COVID. We're starting to see a little bit of an uptick, but clearly a lot of patients who need to apply are not applying to the UDN for very many different reasons. There's one relevant study that I'm going to tell you about. I know there are other studies that have looked at the impact of COVID-19 on individuals with rare diseases, but this particular study is about to be published. It's in press, and it involves one of our UDN sites. And they looked at the impact of COVID-19 on individuals who are undiagnosed as well as being living with rare diseases. The title of their paper is, "It seems like COVID-19 is now the only disease present on Earth." And so brief synopsis of what they found. They did an online survey and they recruited these individuals across Facebook groups. There were about 400 responders. And the impact, the main findings from the pandemic included individuals saying that they had barriers to accessing even essential healthcare, let alone specialist healthcare like the UDN. And they had restrictive COVID-19 visitation policies in hospitals, so family members could not advocate for their sick individual. Many individuals were scared to seek medical care because of the uncertainty and fear regarding COVID-19 risk for themselves. Many reported physical and mental health challenges that had gotten worse during the pandemic. Many children especially had less access to educational and therapeutic services. There were some unexpected positive changes like being with family, being able to work from home, et cetera. But if you look at it from a UDN perspective, probably the barriers to accessing care and the uncertainty and fear about catching COVID themselves has resulted in this decrease in applications that we are facing. So we decided we would do a little bit of a telehealth survey because prior to COVID, The telehealth facilities in the UDN were limited to when we had medically fragile patients who were accepted but couldn't travel to the UDN clinical sites. So we were using it in a very limited way. So we did this way because we wanted to see what effect the pandemic had had on the clinical site activities. Plus, beyond 2022, the UDN has to sustain itself through different models other than NIH. So we wanted to see, can we do telehealth as a long-standing adaptation within the UDN, extending beyond the pandemic? So there are 12 clinical sites in the UDN, as I said. We sent out a survey and all 12 sites responded, and they talked about the telehealth practices prior to and during COVID. So the survey was quantitative, and there were a few text responses allowed as well. So if you look at the different research processes in the UDN, we do consenting as a first step, and the bars in blue say yes, and the bars in red say no. So prior to COVID, most sites were not using telehealth to obtain consent. I have one caveat here. The telehealth here included by definition both telephone and web-based virtual interactions, but the data I'm presenting to you only involved the virtual interactions. Telephone usage has been in place for a long time in the UDN. And if you look at virtual increase during COVID, some sites have started to use this more for consent than they were doing before. Similarly, to obtain and review family history and medical history, prior to COVID, only 3 sites were using this. And now virtual platforms are used by most of the sites to obtain and review medical history. So that's a big plus. The family can do this. Some of their evaluations can be done without their having to travel to the clinical site. Similarly, physical exam. About half the sites are actively using web-based platform for physical exam during COVID. All sites said that there were limitations to this, as you can imagine. Some findings are just not obvious, like skin findings are really hard with telehealth, but sites are beginning to adapt and do it. Similarly, once we have results and a diagnosis potentially, are sites utilizing virtual platforms to give those results? And the answer is yes. More sites are doing this now than prior to COVID. And when we ask sites, do you plan to use telehealth beyond the COVID? I don't know what beyond refer, you know, is really in terms of time frame as well as what context that's going to be in. But in general, all sites said that they would plan to use it long term. 10 of the 12 said absolutely. The other 2 said perhaps. And the most frequent utilization is for the consenting family history and return of results. Some sites were not comfortable using it for physical exam, but they at least thought that part of the evaluations could be done via telehealth. And in addition, these sites also continue to propose telehealth for those medically fragile patients, as well as patients who are so far away that it's hard for them to travel. We asked them, what are the advantages of telehealth? Certainly convenience, the efficiency, flexibility with scheduling the appointment, and you can reach out to participants who are really far out, and you can enroll and start the process very quickly once they're accepted into the network. And then for some sites are doing sequencing first before they see an individual. They were doing this before the pandemic. For those sites, they can actually do a preliminary exam of the participant as they're starting their sequencing of the genomic data. And for those who don't want to come or unable to travel, this is a good option. And they also cited safety for both the participants and staff in terms of protection from COVID. There was absolutely a reduction in travel-related costs. The UDN supports travel for all of the participants, so they don't have to pay for it. And there's a reduced environmental impact due to decreased travel. Some individuals felt that children are less anxious when they're in their own home and they are the subjects of the UDN. And also investigators felt that they could get a sense of family dynamics by examining or interacting with the patient in their own home. There were several limitations as well. And the biggest one was that the physical exam was definitely a limitation. You couldn't do as much as you could in person. Some sites felt that the interactions were less personal and so rapport was harder to establish. There were impediments to communication, as you can imagine. Not all families have internet access. That was alluded to in the prior talk, how Zooms can be very challenging sometimes. Sometimes even when they have the connectivity, the quality of that connection might be poor. So you have freezing and then calls drop off, that kind of thing. And then this was also alluded, some sites felt that if they were going to charge for any of these evaluations, especially moving forward, licensure requirements for out-of-state participants was something that they were grappling with, although there have been some modifications that have been made in that regard. And to get more medical information, they had to work with local providers to arrange some procedures like an echocardiogram, et cetera. And there was difficulty collecting samples, blood samples that was needed, or urine samples. It's harder to do that. You have to work locally with labs and other providers. And some families were very distracted in their home environment, dogs barking or children needing attention. Those are understandable distractions. So points to consider: in general, telehealth affords several advantages, and all the UDN sites, for the most part, feel like they can continue to use this during and beyond the pandemic. And I think broadly, it also applies to clinical research beyond the UDN. Physical exam needs to be optimized to overcome some of these challenges. And then we have to figure out long-term changes in reimbursement for telehealth, especially for the UDN as we move forward and we move to more of a insurance-based service. Although there are changes being made in that as well. And then we talked about the licensure. And one really important thing is that we do need data for patients' perceptions of how well telehealth works for them. What I presented to you is from the provider's perspective. So we do need to find out from our patients, is this working for them? What are the pitfalls and what are the advantages they face? So we are hoping to get some of that information.